Well, I am so, so, so proud of the team that God has blessed us with at Argyle. And they worked hard. They were faithful serving the Lord through the ministry of the singing Christmas tree. And over 1,000 people heard clearly and loudly the true meaning of Christmas. So thank you. Thank you to all who serve. On Sunday, December 24th, we're something a little change. We're having 2 worship gatherings that day. Be one at 10:30 and 5 o'clock. And the 5 o'clock will be a full service, just like a Sunday morning. I'll bring a message. We'll have music. It'll be a good time. So invite people to come with you. 10:30, 5 o'clock, twice on Sunday. Don't get the shakes. It'll be all right. It'll be okay. Today is part 2 of our Christmas series, Songs of the Savior. There is joy in saying yes to God. And our scripture today is Luke chapter 1, verses 26 through 28, so you can follow along in your Bible. Now, I know better than to ask this, because there's a good chance you could crush my spirit. But I'm going to ask anyway. Last week, we saw that Joseph, the stepfather of Jesus, is an example to us that we should follow. Does anyone remember what Joseph was an example of? Obedience. There is a God. Good job. Thanks for listening. Today we're looking at the lives of Mary and Elizabeth, and in their story we will see untimely timing, unexpected encouragement, and unmatched miracle. Let's watch this.
Heaven and nature sing, oh heaven and nature sing, and heaven and heaven and nature sing.
Your song, Elizabeth?
Oh, a little tune I can't seem to get out of my head.
Well, I wish I had your enthusiasm. Look at me. I know I said yes, and I meant it. But I also ran for the hills. Is that someone who's highly favored?
Oh, I'm so glad you came. You ran to the arms of someone who understands more than you know.
It's too much. I mean, no one believes me. My parents look at me like I've betrayed them and I'm lying. And the townspeople look at me like I'm hiding some big secret. I know what I saw. And I know I said yes and I meant it, but is this what I said yes to?
Oh, try not to worry too much. I know from experience that the Lord has a grand way of getting us all on board with his plan. I've laughed more in these 6 months than I have in my whole life.
Well, I wish I could say the same, but Joseph isn't laughing. I mean, he's not laughing at all.
Well, maybe Joseph needs to take some advice from Zechariah. He hasn't said a thing about our situation.
Is it true? Zechariah hasn't been able to speak since you found out you were pregnant?
Isn't it wonderful?
Well, maybe that's just it. Maybe it's just... it's too wonderful.
If the Lord has chosen an old woman beyond her years and a young woman before her time, who are we to argue with him?
Shouldn't I feel more joyful? Because all I keep thinking is, why me?
Mary, this child has been written about for hundreds of years by the prophets, and now it's coming to pass just as the Lord said it would. Oh, joy is not found in knowing why or how God does anything. The joy comes in saying yes to him when he calls.
Well, I guess I did do that.
Oh, yes, you did, my girl. We are so blessed, Mary, that the Lord is fulfilling his promises to us through us. Joy to the world.
video we just watched, we see two ladies whose lives have been turned around before that first Christmas. And the term disrupted definitely fits the life they're facing. See, no one could have expected the events to happen the way they did. So maybe we can relate to that. Have you ever had an unseen, unexpected, powerful disruption in your life? I have. And if you haven't, well, it's coming. Let's look back at how all this started in Luke chapter 1, verse 26. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man named Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman, the Lord is with you." Now this all sounds so sweet and nice, doesn't it? Until we understand that this young teenager who's engaged to be married has some explaining to do. Some explaining to her parents, to her friends, and pretty much with everybody she knows and loves. It's here that Mary's life becomes a life disrupted. And it all begins with untimely timing. You probably know at least some of Mary's story, but what about this other couple we saw in the video, Zechariah and Elizabeth? The scriptures tell us that Elizabeth has been pregnant for 6 months. You say, well, that's nothing unusual. Well, let's read the story. Luke chapter 1, verse 5. In the days of King Herod of Judea, there was a priest of Abijah's division named Zechariah. His wife was from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. Both were righteous in God's sight, living without blame according to all the commands and requirements of the Lord. But they had no children because Elizabeth could not conceive, as both of them were well along in years. See, in the Greek, well along in years means older than dirt. Luke describes an older couple that is beyond the age of having children. He describes them as good people who are living by faith. We learn that Zechariah was a priest. He was a servant of God, yet something was missing. And in a culture that placed a very high value on having children, they had none. The story continues in Luke chapter 1, verse 11. An angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing to the right of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was terrified and overcome with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, because your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you will name him John." The angel's encounter with Elizabeth and Zechariah reminds us that God's timing is always perfect, even when it seems to us to be untimely. Just as Elizabeth conceives a child in her old age, we can trust God in the good times as well as the untimely, challenging events that happen in our life. And they happen all the time, don't they? We will experience surprises along life's way. We will be blessed beyond our imagination in different ways in our life. And then there will be struggles. Struggles so powerful that it brings us to our knees. But no matter what, we have this promise from God's word that we can all claim this morning. Isaiah 41 and verse 10. "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will hold on to you with my righteous right hand. So some of you are here today battling with health trouble, deadly disease, chronic pain. And God says, do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will hold on to you with my righteous right hand. What a promise. I can imagine Zechariah the priest quoting this or reading this verse from Isaiah to a shocked Elizabeth as she realizes that she is giving birth in what we understand to be old age. How can this be, she may have asked. How can this be, she may have screamed. Yet God was working in her life and preparing her. Preparing her to be an encouraging voice to a young and worried teenage girl. The words, do not fear, for I am with you, would have been appropriate for her and Zechariah. And if you are experiencing an untimely time today, please know this, that God is for you and that God is with you. Even in life's disruptions, you can place your trust in God. In this story, we see untimely timing. Number two, unexpected encouragement. See, we pray that you are equipped and encouraged today to be the church every day in your community. That's why we're here today. Let's return to Mary's story. She's been told by the angel that she, a virgin, will conceive and have a son who is to be called Jesus. And also that her much older relative, Elizabeth, will give birth to. Luke continues the story in verse 39 of chapter 1. In those days, Mary set out and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judah, where she entered Zechariah's house and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped inside her, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Then she exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and your child will be blessed. How could this happen to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For you see, when the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby leaped for joy inside me. Blessed is she who has believed that the Lord would fulfill what he has spoken to her." You know, Mary and Elizabeth's joyous greeting reminds us of the power of community. It reminds us of the power of unexpected encouragement. You know, Elizabeth told Mary, "Blessed are you." That may have been the first positive words that Mary has heard in a long time. We live in a world today that is obsessed with judging others. And it was no different in those days. The relationship of Elizabeth and Mary shows us the strength that comes when we encourage each other. But even more, it shows us the strength that comes when we trust in God's word. Again, reading from Isaiah, we have these words of encouragement from God. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 29. He gives strength to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Youths may become faint and weary. Young men may stumble and fall. But those who trust in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not become weary. They will walk and not faint. See, Zechariah could have turned to this passage to give an unexpected encouragement to Elizabeth and Mary. We never know for sure. But what we know is this. During this season of Christmas, as we exchange gifts and share time with our loved ones, may we never forget the importance of being an unexpected encouragement in each other's lives. And may we never forget the words from Isaiah, in our weakness, God is our strength. And whether we're young or whether we're old, may we run and not grow weary. May we walk and not faint. And as we follow where God leads us, we will experience untimely timing, unexpected encouragement, unmatched miracle. In our constantly disrupted lives, may we pause this Christmas season to accept the untimely timing that life will bring our way. May we look for opportunities to be that unexpected encouragement to those around us. And in all the stuff that distracts us from the real meaning of Christmas this season, may we not miss the amazing miracle, the unmatched miracle given to us through the lives of these two babies born 6 months apart all those years ago. One will be a voice crying in the wilderness, "Prepare ye the way." The other will be the one for whom the way was prepared. We read about this in the Gospel of John. Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. So they asked John, "Why then do you baptize if you aren't the Messiah or Elijah or the prophet?" "I baptize with water," John answered them, "even though someone stands among you, but you don't know him." The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." You see, the unmatched miracle is this. For God loved the world in this way. He gave his one and only Son so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. Jesus, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Do you know him today? And if not, please know this, that even in the middle of all of life's disruptions, there is joy in saying yes to God. We haven't said much about Zechariah. You know, the dads always get lost in the telling of birth stories. But they're still very important. And Luke lets us know that Zechariah was a man of God. He was a righteous priest who served God and served his people. In Luke's account, we see that Zechariah was in the holy area of the temple, burning incense as a fragrant offering to God. He probably did not know then what big plans God had for him and Elizabeth. They would have a son, John, and John would prepare the way for the coming Messiah, Jesus. A Messiah that the Apostle Paul would later write about in the book of Ephesians chapter 5. Therefore, be imitators of God as dearly loved children, and walk in love as Christ also loved us and gave himself for us a sacrificial and fragrant offering to God. You know, when we leave this place in a few minutes, may we experience this Christmas season as imitators of God, as dearly loved children, covered in his fragrance. And may the story of Mary and Elizabeth help us to remember these three things. Untimely timing, that God's timing is not always our timing. Number two, unexpected encouragement. Look for ways to lift up those around you. Number three, the unmatched miracle. Did you know the greatest miracle ever performed in the world is not healing the sick? It's not even raising the dead. The greatest miracle ever performed is when God changes a life. The unmatched miracle. The greatest miracle ever performed is real life change through Jesus from the inside out. Let's pray. God, thank you again for the truth of this story and what you want to teach us through this. Help us to learn to rely and accept your timing. Help us to be an encourager. God, thank you for the miracle of salvation. If someone here doesn't know you today, would they accept you as their Lord and Savior? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
It all began here, in darkness, stuck in our brokenness, wandering, directionless, in need of a grace we knew nothing about. It's not much of a beginning, but this is where we were. Fast forward to a starry night in Bethlehem. You see, while we were lost in darkness, God was consumed by love. A love which led him to do the unimaginable. A love which would cost him his son. That night, the heart of Christmas began beating with a rhythm that would change the world. Jesus, the Son of God, our Savior, was born. Grace in a manger. Love in the flesh. Hope had overcome hopelessness. Mercy had triumphed over brokenness. And love had overpowered the darkness. Today, we celebrate that moment. We worship our Messiah. And we stand in awe of the life-changing gift God has given us. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord, the true heart of Christmas.